as he brings forth this word, as he brings forth this word, that he would open my mouth. Because he knows I don't want it to be about me. But I want him to bring out what he's put on my heart this morning. And I pray that ears will hear and hearts will receive. And we won't just be hearers of the word, but we'll be doers of the word. Because we realize that this is a crucial time right now in our nation, in our country, in our state, in our lives. So we want God to continue to give us that beck and call until we just say yes without any doubt, without any hesitations. So Father, just have your way. Continue to have your way. Holy Spirit, just rule and reign in this house and in every house that's gathered in your name today. Let your word go forth under power and under the anointing. And help us, Father God, as was stated, as was prayed, be in tune to your spirit in this upcoming election, Lord. Because we know, Lord God, is not choices that we want to make for either one. But we know, Lord God, that we trust in you. We know, Lord God, as it said, Father God, whoever the president, whoever will be in office, we know, Lord God, that you still rule and reign. And as you call your people, and this is really a call for your people, as was said, in a call by your name, that we will humble ourselves and pray and seek your face, earnestly seek your face, and turn from all wicked ways. Then we will hear from heaven, and our land will be healed. That's a promise, Lord. So let every heart, let every ear hear. Because then we can't be subject to any higher power. There's no higher power but of thee, Lord God. So have your way, Lord God, as we take heed to this 31-day prayer. And truly give you all the glory, honor, and praise. That anything we ask in your name, believing, we shall receive. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I am blessed today. I am blessed to share this month with some blessed people of God. I really am. I am 62 years old today. It will take me the rest of my life to tell you some of the things God has done in my life, some things God has brought me out of. I am thankful this day. I celebrate him this day.
Yeah.
In fact, on my 28th birthday, I was raised up in church, but on my 28th birthday, I gave my life solely to Christ.
Yeah.
On my 28th birthday.
Amen.
And I just thank God for that choice that I made. Because who knows? I know. God knows. And I'm thankful. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So I celebrate Christ. The theme is, I'm not really my theme, but I was just going through my books and I came across something I've written. I've written this back in 2004. And I don't know what pastor or Pastor Chris was ministering on, but I just jot this down. I don't even know if it was what they were ministering on. But I'm just going to read this to you, which brought me to what the message is today. It said, worship. After worship, if you truly worship, you're drained after worship. Because you empty out of yourself all on God through your worship. Then God can do what he needs to do in the midst of us. I don't know what, but I believe that. When we truly are free in our worship, God can do what He can be done in the midst and even after we leave this place. We believe in prayer, we believe in fasting. Worship is a very vital part of all of that. Because when you're praying, your prayer, you can either start out with praise, or usually you do start out with praise, and you just go into a worship. Then you can go into prayer. But at the end of your prayer, you wind up right back into a worship. Because God just takes you there through His Spirit. Amen. So the theme is, He's seeking me. Because the Word says that God is seeking a people that will worship Him in spirit and in truth. So He's seeking me. Make that personal. He's seeking me. He's seeking me. He's seeking us. He's seeking me. That comes from John 4. We're not going to go there yet, but that's where it comes from. John chapter 4, verse 20 and 24. The worship team is a very vital part of service. We know that. It's a very important ministry in the church because they have the ability to affect the congregation into worship. They shouldn't have to prime you. They shouldn't have to tell you to be like Simon says, lift your hands, stomp your feet, clap your hand. It's from the heart. I mean, you can worship. Sometimes the worship is just so high, you may just be rocking. You may get it. My grandmother used to just tap her feet. That's her way of worship. So however the Spirit leads you to worship, just be free to do that. You might not sing like the psalmist team. You might not dance like Zayn. Because if I try to leap right now, you'd take me to the hospital. But that's the way God gave them to worship. And that's how we should worship with all that's within us. Not worrying about who's on the right or who on the left. Right. Not worrying about if my pretty dress is a little torn because I'm sweaty. Just worship. And that's what I want to get across today. Just worship. That's when we enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. When we come in, I know we haven't seen each other all week. We may not have gotten a chance to call or text. But when we come in, we should just be in awe of God. I'm not saying just ignore each other. Acknowledge each other. But don't continue a long conversation. Get in, because I'm so thankful that when we come in, Brother Ty just had the music flowing. Just puts it in an atmosphere to just be in awe of Him. You get caught up in that. I do that at home. Sometimes I'm doing that so much like today that I was running a little late because you just don't want to leave that presence.
Amen.
But we want to be there. We want to be in a lifetime of worship, a lifestyle. That we want that to be us. So when we come in, we should be able to just reverence the Spirit. You know what I think that is? It's like you invite me to your house for dinner. You open the door. I come in. I sit on the chair. You and your family going in the dining room, and I'm still sitting on the chair. Now, you invited me to dinner, but you don't invite me to your table. Wow. That's how it is when we invite God. We say, God in heaven is our praise. Get a high praise. But we just leave Him standing there. Wow. We got to worship God. We have to acknowledge who He is. Yes. God said, I'm seeking a people that will worship me in spirit and in truth. So we have to realize that the praise team is a vital part, but so are we. Because we enhance the praise.
That's right.
You know, they shouldn't have to.
Yes.
Because it's a drawing, it's a pulling. Yeah. But if we're flowing, God is flowing from them and flowing to us, and it's just so awesome. As God is just pleased with our praise. He's pleased with our worship because we're caught up in Him. We're not caught in what we're wearing or what she's wearing or what he's doing or what. We're caught up in Christ. And He loves that. And when He inhabits that, when He is pleased with our praise, anything that's on your heart that you're not even speaking, God knows. Healing takes place. Restoring takes place. We're refreshed in Him. Yes. You know, I can come in from working a double shift on Saturday, and I can be tired, but when the praise starts, It's like, I get new feet, I get new legs.
Amen.
I'm ready to move. But that's what God wants. He wants us to feel relaxed and comfortable and refreshed in His presence. Mm-hmm. But that comes from being free and worshiping Him. Mm-hmm. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Created to worship Him. We hear a song. I'm thankful for the songs because God put songs on people's heart. They came from the Word about being created to worship Him. That's what we're made to do. I mean, not just to work and go through our motion in our everyday life and being mothers and being fathers and being this. And we are created to worship. And when we worship, we can be all those other things.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Brother, amen. Turn to Revelation, chapter 4, verse 11. We're created to worship God. Amen. Revelation, chapter 4.
Chapter 4, verse 11.
Verse 11.
Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive the glory and the honor and the dominion. For you created all things. By your will, they were brought into being and were created.
Amen. You are worthy. That's the praise. You are worthy, Lord.
Yes.
Our God, to receive glory and receive honor. Mm-hmm. I mean, when you're worshiping God, you just filled up. I mean, you feel it. You're refreshed and restored. All that tiredness just leaves you. Because when you bring out a true worship from your heart, it just penetrates your spirit. Or it may be someone over here that's aching and hurting, but when you're worshiping, it just releases them just by your worship.
Amen.
And I know because when I went through a period of mourning, and it was like when I came in, you ever watch the cowboy when he does the rope? And it latches on to something. When I came in, I was so overwhelmed that I could feel my hands being bound and my legs were being bound. Because you know my legs are my instruments of praise.
Amen.
But I can feel myself being bound. And God is saying, be released, be released, be released. And I just kept being bound up. But that's what the enemy does. Because if he can steal your worship,
yes.
When he can steal your praise, he got you. Everything else can take place in your life all around you. Things start falling down, crumbling, your house get out of order. Because you allow the enemy to steal your praise, to steal your worship. But when we realize that we are created to worship Him, that we can't do nothing else but worship Him, the enemy tries, but the chains are broken. You're released to worship. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. God is an awesome God. He's worthy of our praise. Even in the midst of your troubles. When you can't see a way out. You can't see how the bill's going to be paid. When you don't see that next bill coming in. When you don't see that job that you need. When you don't see. Just start worshiping Him.
Yeah.
Just start praising Him. Just be released. And while you're doing that, after you worship, because you dreamed after you worship, man, you're going to just be still.
Mm-hmm.
And your ears are open.
Yes.
And in tune. And God just speaks to your spirit. I got you. Don't worry. He reminds you of His words through worship. He really does. He reminds you what He already said to you. I'll never leave you, forsake you. I'm your God. I mean, He just wraps His arms around you in the midst of worship. Because you start to hear Him. And all those other negative voices and negative things can't. Because God, it's like He just wraps His whole arms around you so you can just hear His voice. That's what comes out of your worship. So we got to worship God. How do we get started worshiping? Brother Luke, Jeremiah, chapter 23, verse 18. Let's start at verse 16.
23, verse 16.
How do we start worshiping God?
Chapter
23,
verse 16. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the false prophets who prophesy to you. and teach you vanity, emptiness, falsity, and futility, and fill you with vain hopes. They speak a vision of their own minds and not from the mouth of the Lord.
You hear the true word of God. And when you hear the true word of God from the Spirit, from your pastor, from whoever's bringing forth the word, when you hear it, yourself, you have to fall on your knees and worship God. Because the word becomes life in you. But you have to hear it. God said, those who have ears, let them hear. But what are you hearing? Are you hearing, I can't do this, I can't make it, I'm never going to be anything? Are you going to hear something that someone else says? Are you going to hear the negative spirits all around you? God, see, I told you you couldn't make it. I told you you would fall. Are you going to hear God's word? Saying you're very and wonderfully made. Saying, I love you, you are mine. And because you are mine, you can do all things through me because I strengthen you to do that. Hear God's word. Don't hear the false prophets. Hear God's word. And don't hear everyone. Because if God sent someone to speak into your life, your spirit already know that God is sending that person. Because your spirit's in agreement with it. But if you're uneasy, that's not God. But how do we know that? By getting in His word, getting before Him, hearing His voice. We have to hear His voice. And sometimes we have to turn the TV off, we have to turn off all the other noise in order to hear His voice. I used to watch my kids do homework. They would have the television on, they would have the radio on, and they would pass their tests by their noise doing their homework. I never could understand how they can have all that on at the same time and be studying. But when it's quiet, it's like they couldn't concentrate. But it's not like that with God. Because when we turn things on that's not of Him, we hear His voice even clearer. But that's through our worship. Amen. 2 Corinthians. Chapter 8, verse 5. How do we get started in worship? How do we begin to worship God? We know we should, we know why, but how do we just start to worship?
2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verse 5. The goal was this gift of theirs, merely the contribution that we expected, but first they gave themselves to the Lord and then to us as His agents by the will of God, entirely disregarding their personal interests. They gave as much as they possibly could, having put themselves at our disposal to be directed by the will of God.
First, they gave themselves to God. That's first. Before you can worship, you have to consecrate yourself to God. Before the psalmists come up here, they have to consecrate their life to God.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
They have to be kind of sing. But to consecrate your life to God, then such an awesome worship come forth.
Yes.
Then they can give more of themselves to others because they're worshiping God. They put themselves to God first. The first time we heard the word worship. Anyone know the first time the word worship was mentioned in the Bible? Anyone? Genesis? With Abraham? Abraham was asked to sacrifice his son, Isaac. It was a total because this was his love. This is who he loved and what he loved best. This was considered his all. Abraham was a rich man. He had much. But his son was his possession, his love, the love of his life. And he was asked to sacrifice his son. He willingly did it. He went up to the mountain The servant was with him. He told the servants, okay, you stay here while me and the boy go up to worship. Now, how can that be considered worship? How can sacrificing your child, sacrificing what you love most, be worship to God? Because you're willing to give it all. You're willing to give it all to God, but not holding anything back. Because when we do that, God gives us much more. He was willing, it was the willingness of his heart. And that's what God wants. That's why he's seeking us. The willingness of our hearts to worship him. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. How do we worship? Okay, we realize that we were created to worship. We know some of how to get started in worship. How do we worship? It's just lifting your hands, worship. That's a form of worship. Stomping your feet, worship. That's a form of worship. But it starts in the heart. You may not sing, like I said, you may not dance, but God's given us, given every one of us, a form of worship. Everyone. But it's in our hearts. And we have to be led by the Spirit to worship. Let's go to John chapter 4. I'm sorry, before that, go to Hebrew first. Hebrew chapter 13, verse 15 and 16.
Hebrews
13, verse 15 and 16.
Hebrews 13, verse 15 and 16. Through him, therefore, let us constantly and at all times offer up to God a sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of lips that thankfully acknowledge and confess and glorify his name. 16. Do not forget or neglect to do kindness and good, to be generous and distribute and contribute to the need of the church as embodiment and proof of fellowship, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God.
Form of worship. Giving is a form of worship. Because God said he loves a cheerful giver. We only use that for offering, but that's not just for offering. It is for offering, but it's not just for offering. It's for everything.
Yes.
Freely given of yourself. And if we continue in the things of God and sacrifice praise, that means when you're tired, when you don't feel like it, no matter what's going on in your life, sacrifice a praise to him by the fruit of your lips. Open your mouth. Open your mouth. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I hear someone, as a child, I always rebelled when somebody would tell me what to do. And by that I meant when someone said, well, do this, do that, do it this way. I would always rebel, even as a child. And I know who you're saying, even as an adult. But I do. I rebel. That's in me. I'm sorry to rebel. Because I believe that I'm led by the Spirit. And the Spirit leads me in all truth. Now, I'm not talking about, like, if I don't know how to fix something in my house. Because I will watch, I will hear, and then I will do. But I'm just talking about the simple things, like, to worship. It sounds simple, but I mean something that should be free from my heart to do. And I do rebel when someone tells me how to do what I know God is leading me to do. And let's make it simple. Even on my job, being there a long time, and then someone come along, someone new, and I just look at him. Even my boss, I just look at him. He's, oh yeah, you know how to do that. Because I believe you should trust me enough to allow me to do what I've already been taught. Because that's what God wants. He said, you've sat underneath the word, You've heard. You've learned. Now do. That's why I thank God for this house. I thank God for our pastors because they train us up and then they release us to do what we've been trained to do. That's why when you go through the classes, it's okay, now what would you like to do? They release you to do what's in you to do. And you're blessed like that. And that's what God wants. It's okay, you've heard. You've heard the word. You've learned. Be released to do that. So don't rebel. So he's telling me, don't always rebel. Sometimes just listen. Maybe there's a new way to do it. Maybe you've been doing it the same way too long.
That's
good. So I'm thankful that. I'm thankful for that ear to hear. Because sometimes I do rebel. But God is working on me. He's seeking me as well. Amen. Amen. And let's go to John chapter 4, verse 23. And 24.
Chapter 4, verse 23 and 24. A time will come, however, indeed, it is already here, when the true, genuine worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth, reality. For the Father is seeking just such people as these as his worship. God is a spirit, a spiritual being, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Amen. Because God is a spirit.
Because he is.
So we have to worship him in our spirit and truth. Means you're not doing it because someone tells you to do it, you're doing it because it's in your heart to do it. Otherwise, you're doing it grudgingly. Mm-hmm. And God loves a cheerful giver. Even your worship, giving it cheerfully. Remember when Zay was teaching the mature group how to dance, he would say, smile. Just smile. Even if you mess up, just smile. It's your face. It's your response to something. And that's what God wants. He wants your response to be genuine. I mean, he can see our hearts. You may see my face, but God can see our hearts. But when you're smiling, it just brings your heart out. Even, you know, sometimes when you don't feel good, if you just smile, sometimes you don't feel like smiling, I understand. And somebody comes to tell you to smile, it makes you not smile even more.
That's true.
Smile. But when you do smile, it just opens everything up. It's like having eucalyptus in a steam room. Sorry, it's a natural thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Just opens you up. And you can just relax and just feel the presence of God all around you. He's all around you when you allow your spirit to be opened up. So you gotta worship God in spirit and in truth. And I love that he said, there's come a time that you won't worship on this mountain. In other words, you may not be able to come into the doors of this church to worship. Does that block or stop your worship? Absolutely not. Because we should know how to worship God wherever we are, even as on your job. I'm not saying jump for joy in the midst of your job, and but if the spirit hits you, don't hold back. Amen. Don't hold back. But I'm just saying, be free in your worship. Have your worship at home. When things are going on and you had a rough day, just, if you can't get a praise out of your mouth, turn on some worship music.
Amen.
Let the Lord just refresh you. And that comes from the worship. So let's worship him in spirit and in truth. Because there will come a time, as you see, they're trying to block the church from being free. Mm-hmm. But if we allow our hands to be bound and we don't break through in our worship, we're praying, we're fasting, but we got to break through in our worship because that enhances our prayers. That help us to fast even longer. Amen. I always set aside, ever since my 28th birthday, I always set aside the month of October for my fasting and prayer. So this 31 days just right on time as well. Because I want God to do a new thing. Not that he can't do a new thing in me without me praying and fasting, because I know he's trying to do a new thing in me. But by me setting this month aside for that, because when I was 28, I promised God that I was going to live for him, that I was going to just forget about all the things I've been through all the way from my childhood. I remember when I was three years old going through some things. But on my 28th birthday, being sick and tired of being sick and tired, I promised God that I would do my best to live for him. But I know my best is not enough, but his best is. His best is, he says his grace is sufficient. That means his best is enough for us. So setting this time aside for prayer and fasting and getting close to the Lord. He may tell you to do it one day a week. He may tell you to do it on a Thursday. But have a time. Have a time to set aside a day, a week, a month. However the Spirit leads you. For not just prayer, but also for fasting. Because that empties you out. You know, even taking detoxing your body. Doing a spiritual, because when you detox your body, you also want to do a spiritual detox.
Amen.
Because you're getting rid of the natural junk, but you also have to get rid of the junk that's in your spirit, in your mind, in your heart. Because we want to be complete in him.
That's right.
So when we prostrate ourselves before a holy God, we want to get up new. We want to get up in awe. When he says something, we just want to say a yes. We want to have a hesitation. We want to just say yes. So freely worship God. Freely. Psalms 100 says, "Into his gates with thanksgiving." 100, verse 4 says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise and bless his holy name."
Yes.
Psalms 150, verse 4-6 says, "Praise him with the tremble and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the sounding cymbals. Let everything that have breath,
yes,
praise the Lord."
Yes,
now once you get into that praise, then you're going to go into worship. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Proof. How do you know that you're a true worshiper? How do you know? I already talked about Abraham. Abraham was a true worshiper because he was willing to give his all. He was willing to give his best. He was willing to give what he held dear to his heart for worship to his Father. Romans, Brother Luke 12, 1 through 2, 1 and 2. How do you know you're a true worshiper? What's the proof in your life that you're a true worshiper?
Romans 12, 1 and 2. "I appeal to you therefore, brethren, and beg of you in view of all the mercies of God, to make a decisive dedication of your bodies, presenting all your members and faculties as a living sacrifice, holy, devoted, consecrated, and well-pleasing to God, which is your reasonable, rational, intelligent service and spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, this age, fashioned after and adapted to its external, superficial customs, but be transformed, changed by the entire renewal of your mind, by its new ideals and its new attitude, so that you may prove for yourselves what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God, even the thing everything which is good and acceptable and perfect in his sight for you.
That says it all right there. That's how you know you're true worship. When it's pleasing in the sight of God. And it's a living sacrifice. Worship is alive. It's not a dead thing.
Amen.
It should be alive. If you go into a worship service and it's dead, leave out of there. Mm-hmm. If you can't start it, if you can't, because sometimes when you go in another house, because I know I've been there, and you're trying to press into it, you're trying to really, I don't want to say get my praise on, because it's not about getting my praise on, but it is about being free to worship.
Yes.
And everyone worships differently, I understand that.
That's right.
But the spirit is the same. The spirit of God is the same.
Yes.
So even if you don't clap your hand, even if everyone don't stand up, even if it's a choir standing up front, it still should be the same spirit.
Right.
And God said we want to worship him in spirit and in truth. So we don't come to be entertained. We come to worship the Lord. I love that song. We come into this house and magnify his name. I'm not going to sing, that's not my gift. But I love that, because that's why we come. We come into his house to magnify his name and to worship him. So that's why we come. We don't come just to sit like we're in a library, like Pastor Chris always says. We don't come to be entertained by the psalmist. We come to magnify. Because when you worship, it magnifies. And we bless his holy name. Amen. I'm not going to be before you long, but I just want you to know when you're a true worshiper. Let's go to Luke 18. Let's skip 18. Let's go to 17. 17, verse 11.
Luke 17, verse 11. As he went on his way to Jerusalem, it occurred that Jesus was passing along the border between Samaria and Galilee.
That's it for you,
that's 11.
Okay, well, 11 through 16, but let me just touch on it to say, it's still talking about the Samaritan woman, but he was telling her that it comes a time that you won't worship at this mountain. Because God wanted, Jesus was letting her know that whether you worship at this mountain or whether you worship in Jerusalem, it's worship. Because you're so sad, it's just like being in this church. If you're not in this church, because I had people call me one Sunday morning and said, pray for me. When you go to church, pray for me. And I have to let them know I don't have to wait until I get in the church to pray for you. I can pray for you right now. No. Pray for me when you get to the altar. Because that's tradition. Interrupt them and just pray for them right now. Because I might not make it to church. I might not make it to the altar. So you have, and this is what Jesus is telling. There comes a time where you may not make it to this mountain. Because what you're worshiping is that mountain. You're worshiping that place. You're not worshiping God. Because if you was worshiping God, you worship him wherever you are. That's a true worshiper. When you know you can just worship God. When you in the supermarket, you see a saint, you just break out into worship. You can't help yourself. Amen? No matter where you are, worship God. And then when you're free like that, you know you're a true worshiper. Amen? Now we're learning from Jesus. Jesus went out early in the morning to be with his Father. He left the rest and went out early. And it wasn't that he had to go to a certain place to get with his Father, but he didn't want any distractions. And sometimes you have to do that. My best time, I leave in the morning at 6:30, meet to get on the bus about 20 after 6. And I'm walking, and it's usually dark, but I'm just walking and praising, just thanking God, just in awe of him. Because I just love just seeing all of his glory.
Amen.
And early in the morning, the cars are still moving, but it's almost like a stillness. You could just see God in everything. You could just hear his voice in everything. And you just finish your prayer. I mean, you're not worried. I mean, it's dark. You're not worried about who's on your right or your left. I mean, you have wisdom, but you're just in awe of God. You're just meditating, concentrating on him. I just love that time with him. And even getting off at 10 o'clock at night and just walking and just thanking him for giving me strength in my body, my mind, and spirit to make it through and deal with people sometimes you have to deal with. Just thank God that he intervened. So everything you do can be a worship to God when you release to worship. Amen?
Amen.
I mean, there's many scriptures. I mean, seek it for yourself about how to worship, why you worship, and the freedom to worship God. I mean, I have many, but I don't want to tarry long. But my main thing in closing, I want to go with Daniel chapter 6. Let's go with 3 first. Sorry. Let's do Daniel. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16 through 18.
Daniel chapter 3, verse 16
yes.
through 18. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, it is not necessary for us to answer you on this point. If our God, our servant, is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image which you have set up.
In other words, there's nothing else to be worshipped but God.
Mm-hmm.
Our jobs, our children, nothing else will we worship but God. And we know there's so many different images that's being placed before us right now in this day and age. But we have a mind made up and heart set that we will worship nothing else but God. Even though you hear, well, there's only one God. You hear it from the Muslim, I hear it from the Pakistani, I hear it from the Asians. No. Your God is not my God, because you don't worship the same God. But God is for all. He said he came for the world. But it's up to the world to receive him and to worship him. Because like Daniel and the king realized, your God is God. And that's what we have to show forth. So they'll know without a doubt, our God is God. But it's only come when we're free. Amen. Amen. Let's go to Daniel chapter 6, verse 10 to 12.
Now, when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house. And his windows being opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he got down upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he had done previously. Then these men came thronging by agreement and found Daniel praying and making supplication before his God. Then they came near and said before the king concerning his prohibitory decree, have you not signed and pleaded that any man shall make a petition to any god or man within 30 days, except of you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? King answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be changed or repealed.
Was that 12?
Yeah, that was 12. 6-4.
Okay, amen. The bottom line is no matter what come up against you, like Daniel said, there's no stopping him. No stopping us now. And we got to realize that there's nothing that's going to stop us from worshiping the God that we serve. And we we have to be faithful to our God and sincere in our worship, free to worship, because it comes a time, and we see it in movies, we see it all over, even with this upcoming election, because it's real. We see how they're trying to turn and make us to believe that wrong is good. The Bible said that. And good is wrong. But if we're steadfast and unmovable and free to worship the God we serve, God will do great and mighty things in the midst of us. Amen.
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 Free to worship God. be free in this house. This is a house where you can be free. We're not looking at what you have on. We're not looking at what you're wearing today. We're not looking at who you believe you are. God says, look at no one after the flesh. So be free to worship. If you weren't free before this day, be free to worship. Am I going to be looking at you next Sunday to see if you're free? Absolutely not. That's between you and God.
That's right.
But I'm just urging you to be released. Because when you're free in your worship and you go out there, you're still worshiping. Because you're worshiping in your heart. You can break out on your job. Your boss may be coming up against you. Your job may be closing, but you know what? You can worship in the midst of it all. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Be free. Worship the Lord. Spirit.